Good morning. It's plenty hot, isn't it? Welcome to Immanuel Ministry Church this morning. We're glad everybody could come out. Kind of a slim crowd this morning, but that's all right. I know there's several people traveling, including our pastor and all his family. So we want to pray our blessings over them. This is a much needed time for them just to enjoy all their family. I think all of them are gone, so that's a great thing. I got to see some posts where they were all traveling the last couple days on Facebook, so exciting time for them. If y'all are watching, enjoy yourself. But we want to welcome everybody here this morning to Immanuel Ministry Church. Do we have any first-time visitors here this morning? If you are, we'll get your information. Brother Roy, we got one back here. Get a card to them. We just want to just have an understanding of who you are here this morning, and we just want to be able to pray over you and bless you as a church, and thank you for coming this morning. We enjoy having you. Brother Travis is going to lead us in prayer this morning as we get started.
Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for just another opportunity to just come in your house and worship you. We just thank you for the beautiful day you have made, and we just want to rejoice and be glad in it, Lord. And Lord, we just want to enter into your presence. We want to worship you, and we want to worship you in spirit and in truth, Lord. So we love you, Lord, and we just ask you to be here in our midst, and we know you will, because your word, we know what your word says. You said where two or three are gathered together in your name, you'll be in the midst of us. So, Lord, we welcome you. We welcome you, sweet Holy Spirit, to just come in here and indwell in this place. And I thank you, Lord, that every need will be met. And Lord, I just thank you for your presence that's going to be here this morning, Lord. We love you, and we praise you, and we thank you for it all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. A few announcements this morning before we get started. Miss Cynthia Perkins. Oh, she's here. Is she here? Not here today? Okay. Well, she has a large variety of beautiful daylilies and irises that she wants to give away. So if you are wanting some of those, get with her, and she would love to help you out with that and to provide them for you. Also, next Saturday, Miss Charlene Crane is orchestrating a yard sale. It's basically, there's not going to be any prices on it, to my understanding. Is that correct? It's just for donations only, but it is to support the three ministries that we have going on. There's tables set up out front that it kind of explains those. And if you've got anything that you don't need any longer, just kind of like a yard sale type thing, if you're wanting to bring something to donate to that, be glad to have you to help set up. Also, somewhere around 7 to 7:30, they're going to be setting up on Saturday morning. If you can come out and help them do that, set tables up or whatever they have. They're in need of hangers. If you've got some hangers that you can bring, make sure you've got everything on a hanger as you bring it too. If you want it hung up or folded, ever how you want it, I guess, if you don't need a hanger, if you're going to fold it on a table. But just make sure we've got those tables set up out there. And if you've got it, she said, if you've got any of those clothes racks, those just little mobile clothes racks that you have maybe in your closet or storage room or something like that, bring those so that they can hang the clothes on those as well. If it rains, it says the sale will be canceled, but they will look at that closer to time. The sale will be from 8 to 3 here at the church on October 10th, which is next Saturday. Also, there's going to be a Pastor Appreciation Day set for October the 25th. It was first announced the 18th, but they are moving it to the 25th. Yeah, all right, it didn't get changed up there. But it is the 25th. There's going to be a potluck meal and a time of fellowship after the service. If you would like to give a gift, it said it can be done after the service or at the meal. We hope that everybody can stay. It is a potluck, so if you're going to stay and you already know it, try to bring something. It's always helpful to make sure we have plenty enough food, but there's always plenty enough food to go around. So if you happen to slip up that day and forget it, please stick around, though. We want you here for fellowship. Brother Phillip really enjoys those times of fellowship with everyone around, food and just time of spending together. It says also you are invited to a baby shower in the fellowship hall for Taylor and Kyle Riggs on October 24th from 1 to 3. They are having a baby boy. I'm sure they had plenty of girls things, but they are having a boy now this time, and they're excited about that. It's exciting to watch her develop in this pregnancy, and I know she's excited about this time as well, and we want to pray for them and support them. Hallelujah night. I think Brother Ransom's going to talk about that here in just a second. Also, Marilyn Thompson has set up a display of baby bottles to collect money for Crossroads Life Center in Glasgow. Your contributions will help women in Hart and surrounding counties. So they have those baby bottles set up there. And what we've done in the past is you take one home with you, loose change, dollar bills, 5, 10, 20, 50, hundreds, whatever you got, throw them in there. They'll be happy with that. But it is to support the pregnancy centers there for these unwed mothers. And yes, ma'am. We'll do good with transferring that to our online audience here. In 2018, the support that came through with this ministry of the baby bottles was able to help 600, right? Approximately 600. And then in 2019, the money increased so much. It was 1,300 different ones that it was able to bless. And the first year was 11 salvations. And in 19... There were 22 salvations that came through that ministry. So that's a blessing. You're not just helping someone financially, but you're also showing the love of Christ to people who don't know it. And sometimes that may be the first person they've got to see with the love of Christ shared to them. And it's life-changing to them. You see, we've got 30 people right there, 30-some people right there that have come to know the Lord through that ministry. Don't you think that's worth it? Absolutely. If it was one, it would have been worth it. But the blessing that comes through that. So it's just, you know, what they're asking ultimately was just your spare change. You empty your pockets at the end of the day. If you've got any change, put it in that baby bottle for the next month or whatever it is till they take that up. You'd be surprised how much that'll add up. You probably got some in your car you could get rid of too. I know I have a little thing in my underneath my console that has several in there as well. October activity calendars are in the foyer. There will be children's church after praise and worship today. Brother Rob and Miss Jamie will take them down stairs in the youth room for that. Paula is also in need of egg cartons. She's got chickens laying like crazy, which is a blessing. And she is in need of some egg cartons. So I know we had stopped that at one time because the church was just running over with them. And they were just piling up out in the foyer. So if you've got some, I'm sure she would be blessed for you to give them to her. And she would like to take care of that. Also, there are coats in the foyer on a rack. My understanding, it's mostly female coats or all female coats. And they're free. So if you are needing a jacket or coat or anything like that for this upcoming winter, please help yourself out here before you leave today. And see what's out there, and hopefully something would work out for you. I think that's all I have for right now. There's a deacon's meeting today, right after church. So Brother Ransom is going to talk about Hallelujah Night.
I just want to talk about Hallelujah Night real quick. We kind of been talking the last couple weeks about it and had some ideas of what we were going to be doing. Our goal for this year is obviously to be as safe as possible, to make it a fun environment that we can have fellowship but also be safe. And so we've got a couple ideas floating around. I'm going to have some sheets out in the foyer this coming week with some things that you guys can kind of like sign up for, just saying who's bringing what as far as like soup-wise and stuff like that. We're just going to kind of keep it simple this year. So you'll be hearing more from me in the next couple weeks, but it is still going to be happening. Just want to let you know.
Sorry, I missed one announcement here on as well. On October the 8th, which is a Thursday, on Box 2 Radio, is that right, 91.5, a Better Way program with Judy Jones and Miss Karen Bracken starting at 9:30. And then also Dustin and Barbara Toller will begin a series on the Constitution Please tune in and enjoy this teaching and learn new things from Miss Judy this morning. So Box 2 Radio starting October 8th on Thursday, 91.5 FM. Is that correct? The series that Brother Dustin and Barbara. Okay. So the whole month of October beginning at 9:30 each day. Or is that on just on Thursday? On Thursdays at 9:30. All right, guys. You guys ready to worship? You ready for worship? What does worship mean to you? Kind of shaking off all this world and everything off of us and just consecrating ourselves with the Lord. Amen? Ushering in the presence of God. We talked on that this morning in our youth class, and we spent some time just seeking God, just preparing ourselves. You prepare yourselves in several different ways to come to church or to go to work or to do a lot of things in your life. How much are we preparing ourselves to worship our Lord? Are we consecrating ourselves? Are we getting rid of the junk around us, the distractions that are around us, so that we can truly focus on the things of God? Also, it ushers in His anointing. I think Brother Josh would appreciate the anointing of the Holy Ghost this morning. I know he's got it. It's all over him. You can talk to him and understand it's all around him. But this is ushers in the time to hear His word this morning as well. So, you guys, let's participate this morning and enter into a good time of worship this morning.
We're so thankful to have you guys here today. If you guys would, just stand with us, enter into worship like Les was talking about. In the Old Testament, they always had the worshipers go first into battle. They always had the worshipers go before the Ark of the Covenant. That's what we talked on this morning in youth class, was that the worshipers went first, and they went in with withholding nothing back. They went in with everything they had. They didn't care how it looked. They didn't care how it sounded. They just went in wanting to worship God. So we just invite you in, Holy Spirit. We want to worship you, Father God, this morning.
I will. want you first all for your glory,
something new out of us today, God. We just welcome you in. We welcome you in the tough times, in the times that are easy. We trust you, Father, that you are making something new.
Soil high, and I surrender. just bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Oh, Jesus, bring new wine out of me.
Father, it's our desire to bring glory and honor to you in everything that we do. Father, we want to sing your name from the rooftops. We want to proclaim your name in the valley. We want to proclaim your name on the top of every mountain. So, Father, we just sing this as worship to you this morning. Let us go before the people in worship. Let us go forward in victory. Father, we just stand before you now in victory. We just ask you to move across our nation. Move across us as a people for your glory and for your good.
Of you. All that. place into your loving hands, then I am yours. Oh, I am yours. All that I am, I place into your loving hands, then I am yours.
Rooftops, we will proclaim. Every knee will bow down. Every tongue will proclaim. Won't have a choice at that point. You will bow down to the name of Jesus. Let's do it now. Now is the time to bow down. Now is the time to proclaim the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, right? Worthy, 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 worthy of way more than we could ever offer. But isn't it worth it? It's worth our time, our efforts, our energy to worship our Savior, the one who is living, the one who is risen, the one who is seated at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for us. On your behalf, fighting for you, so that you can gain heaven and all the blessings on this earth that come with it. He's a good God, guys. He's a good God. He's a gracious God. Worthy of our worship, worthy of our praise this morning. We're going to sing another song here, but we want you to have a time to bring your tithes and offerings this morning to the Lord. We raise a hallelujah, the highest form of praise. We raise a hallelujah, the same in any language spoken. Hallelujah to our King. Amen. So if you've got your offering this morning, we have our plates up here on the sides and in the front. We ask that you come forth and give of your tithes and offerings as an act of worship to Him today. Amen? As an act of sacrifice and as an act of worship today. So come, guys, and give your offering this morning. Amen.
Louder than the unbelief.
to raise a hallelujah to you, Father. To raise a hallelujah through our worship. To raise a hallelujah through our lives. To raise a hallelujah through those that we impact. That every single thing our hands touch, every single place that our feet go, Father, that we would be raising a hallelujah to you. That people would see our lives as acts of worship to you, God. That we would be living sacrifices, walking with the fire of the Holy Spirit for you, Father. Through every single act of worship, through giving our tithe, through praying for the sick, through speaking words of knowledge and wisdom over those that we encounter every single day. We just thank you, Father, that we have the ability to walk as living sacrifices for you. Just use us, Father God. Use us as youth, use us as adults, use us as every single people, Father, for you. Every single nation, every single tribe, every single tongue for you, Father. We just thank you for how you've worked in this place today. We just thank you, Father. We will raise a hallelujah to you with everything that we do. It's in Jesus' mighty name that we pray these things.
Bring it in and pray over the offering, please. Go ahead and pray.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your help. This is a day that you have made me really good. That's why we're here today.
Guys, youth does an amazing job, don't they? They know how to bring the spirit in. They're hungry. I love seeing that. They're hungry. I remember being in a youth group that was like that when I was here, when I got saved, and we was hungry. We was hungry to find the truth. And a lot of times teens are always searching for something, and they're going to find something. Whether you show them the truth or not, they're going to find something. And it's a good thing to let them find the truth, find God's word and how good it can be to them. And there's a video that I think he's got ready to show you real quick.
Music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come. Longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the It's all about you, Jesus. every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my
Hallelujah. Every time I see that, I can't help but wonder what those kids are doing right now, how they're doing. And like they was talking in class this morning, that in a lot of countries, women and girls are not respected like they are here in America. And India is one place like that, that in their religion, they worship animals, so their kids are nothing more than dogs. It's just like a dog. That's how they treat the girls. Many of those kids you see at the end of that was found in garbage dumpsters, laying on the street, abandoned, left to die because their parents didn't want them no more. They seen him as a hassle, not a blessing. Because they can't carry on the family name, they mean nothing. God did not design us that way. God designed us to love. I I remember this one time we was over there in this big tourist area, and they said, Josh, you have to go. You've got to see this while you're here. And in my heart, I was like, no, there's no need me going. I don't believe in Hinduism. There's no need in me going seeing what they think that their gods created. I didn't see no sense in seeing that. I wasn't there for that. So the driver insisted that we go. And we stopped and we went in, and I remember walking down the street, and here's these temples that was carved out of the ground, and there's this big old rock over here that they say that this god just moved over there, and I didn't quite understand it, but. And then we found this little man. And at that moment, I realized why we needed to go. It wasn't to see what they believe. It was to change what they believe. And I remember going to this guy, and this guy was peddling out these little carved idols. You could buy them in a set. He had them in sets. And he was going to the local gift shop, picking them up and peddling them out in this, around these temples and in this park. And that's how he was making his ends meet. That's how he was making a living. And he was going up to everybody and everybody trying to sell these things. And I'm sad to say I seen more Americans with those idols than I did anybody else. Trying to play like they was Hindu. And I remember sitting there talking to him, and my friend that you've seen in the video, he was talking to him in Tamil, and which is the local language there, and he was talking to him and explaining to him that there is one God, not many, but there is one true God. And I remember that man submitting himself to the gospel and getting saved right there in front of that temple where all these other people was trying to find what was real in that temple. But an old man found what was really real at the steps of that temple with the real Jesus. And I remember talking to him, and we was explaining to him, we said, do you know what you're doing? He said, yeah, I'm selling these to make ends meet. You know, the tourists are buying them. And we explained to him that what he was doing was actually selling idols. But there is one God. And what he was doing was wrong, and it wasn't right. And I've never seen an old man run so fast back to the gift shop to give them back. You see, when you bring somebody truth, it changes things. It changes hearts. It mends bridges. Forgiveness comes. You see, his love draws us to repentance. You see, God's grace is more than saying, okay, I messed up, his grace is going to cover it. It's so much deeper than that. This morning, I want to talk to you about the blood covenant with Jesus. A lot of people really don't even understand what kind of covenant they're actually in. They know that Jesus is good, and Jesus saved me. I was a sinner, and Jesus died for me. They understand that, and they accept that, and that's great. But let's talk about the blood covenant and what it really means to be in covenant with Christ. So you see, in the Old Testament, they had a they had a thing that was called the Blood Covenant, and a lot of other, if you get studying the Blood Covenant and blood covenants, most people, they done it about the same way. You can study it, and there's rituals and steps that you take to become into a blood covenant. But one of the, I can't touch it on at all because we have just a short time. But one of the main things they do is, let's say I was going to come into covenant with you, and first thing I would do is I'd take off my robe and I'd give my robe to you. And you'd take off your robe and you'd give it to me. And you see, if you'll notice, whenever you read the Bible and you talk about, you look and you see what, even like the sick people and that, they had certain stuff that they wore to, so it shown that they were sick. Everybody know that that person's sick, so don't get around him. He's wearing that certain color clothes. So if I take your robe and you take my robe, that means I become who you are and you become who I am. The next thing I would do is I'd take off my belt and hand my belt over to you. And then you would take off your belt and you would hand it to me and we'd put them on. And understand, they don't have pants like these that the belt was meant to hold up your pants. That belt was meant to hold up your armor. That belt was meant to hold up your weapons. So whatever weapons you have became mine. Those are my weapons now. My weapons, whatever I had on my belt, became yours. The next thing we would do is that we would take an animal and we'd split it in half. Completely in half, a bloody mess. And we lay aside here and aside there. Jesus. Just like that animal, he was beaten beyond recognition. Then we would stand in between those two splitted halves. And there's certain, some people have certain walks they would do this and that. And we'd meet back up in the middle face to face. And we'd submit into that covenant with each other. And we'd ask God that if we tried to break that covenant, let the same thing happen to us as this flesh that we just split in two. You see, it's more than just saying, I will. It's more than going to the bank and signing a note, but if I default, you know, it's just going to hurt my credit. That's why in the New Testament it says, don't enter into this lightly. Don't take it lightly. It's something that's be taken seriously. And then the next thing we would do is we'd cut our palms. Okay? You'd cut yours, I'd cut mine. They would be bleeding. And the next thing we'd do was hold our palms together and we'd mingle that blood together. We'd be rubbing them in. That way, in a sense, your DNA comes in contact with my DNA and my DNA becomes into your DNA, so now we become one. We become the one bloodline. And what that's representing is that everything inside his bloodline, whew, Everything inside his bloodline now becomes mine. Oh, please get this. Please understand this. It'll change your life forever. Even after being a Christian, realizing what the blood covenant really means will change your life forever. Forever. And you're mingling that blood together. That means his family's for me. Because they have to be, because a member of that family is in covenant with me. It doesn't matter if it's somebody on the street that you become in blood covenant with or somebody in the castle. Glory to God, we are in covenant with the greatest. Do you realize what you have? Another thing that will happen with a covenant is that whenever you're out alone or whatever, and a bunch of thieves or anything comes against you, all I'd have to do is raise my hand and show that scar. And 99.9% of the time, they would run away. Why? They don't know who you're in covenant with. It could be a whole army waiting for you to just scream out. And they would come because they're in covenant with you. They have to. Or unless they want to be treated like the two halves of flesh that was split and put aside, like they agreed upon. You see, when I worship God, I think about the covenant many times. But especially when I start getting emotional and I reach my hands to the heavens, I think in my mind, that's me reaching out, showing my scar. Showing the world that I'm in covenant with Christ. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Because if it does, I have all of heaven backing me. All of heaven. If God's the creator, and the correct creator is the one that said, I want to be in covenant with you, who can be against you? Who can hold you back? Who can keep you from being who God called you to be? You? You. Am I guilty of that? Absolutely. I'll be the first to tell you that I'm guilty of that. Guilty of many other things too. But one thing God does that amazes me, and a lot of people don't understand or get, is God knew who you was when he called you. He knows how you talk. He knows how you think. He knows what your home life's like. But he's still calling out for you. I remember sitting down in a little shed I had over there that I was selling metal in before we moved to Tulsa to go to Raymond. It's a 4x16 building, a little small building. And at that point, I never made anything. I'd just make phone calls and make it happen. I was the middleman. That's what I done. So in the wintertime, I had a lot of time on my hands, so I was reading. And at that time, I was doing Rhema by mail, and I was getting my books in, and I was reading. And I remember one time sitting there behind the desk, I was watching people. If anybody knows where that's at, there's a hill directly up the road. It goes straight up the hill. And I was sitting there watching cars come back and forth up the hill. And I was trying to think of who I wanted to model my preaching style after. It's kind of funny, you know, that we would think of something like that. But you ask many ministers and that stuff that they've gone through. Many ministers have gone through that. You know, they want to be who the person that brought them up. You know, Brother Phillip, man, do y'all realize how good of a pastor y'all have? Glory to God. He is good. He loves God. And I can tell you right now, He loves you. He really loves you. But I remember sitting there and I said, God, what about this person? What about that person? And you got to understand, when I talk to God, I talk to Him like He's my buddy. He's Papa. You know, I talk to Him just like I'm talking to you right here. It don't have to be nothing special. He knows how I talk. He called me when I talked this way, so why not? You'll never get the realization of Christ until you become real with Him. Do you understand what I'm saying? That He will never become really real to you until you're real with Him. And I remember sitting there and I said, God, what about this one? God, what about that one? You know, I really like how His preaching style. Maybe we can just kind of mingle those two in. And you know, it's really funny. I find myself laughing at it, but I've done that. And talking to God just like this, and He said, Josh, I said, what? He said, if I wanted another so-and-so, I would have made one. I was like, okay. I shut up. Yes, okay. I remember this book is good for edification and grooming you from the front to the back. I want you to know that. From Genesis to Revelation, it's good for you. The Bible says that it's even healing into our flesh. The reason the Bible has never went out of print or never got old is because it's living. The more you read it, the more you meditate on it, the more it becomes alive to you. The more you look at it, the more you open your heart to it. It becomes very real. And I was reminded just a second ago of another thing that happened. I was on my way to jail in Hart County, and I was blessed to be able to go there every Thursday night before we moved. And I got to teach over there for 2 years straight, every Thursday night. Every Thursday night. And it was funny. If you know of any of my past at all, you'll understand this. There was several that would come in there and be like, hey, what are you doing here? On stateside. I'd be like, sit down, let me tell you. But God opened so many doors through that because they knew that I knew what they was going through. And if God could change me, He could change anybody. Like Paul, He was Saul. And the light shined around him. And he thought he was right. He thought he was doing good. Many times we think that we're doing the right thing. We think we're doing good. He was educated. Top of the class. Then that light shined around him and his world changed. He realized that he was actually persecuting the truth. The spoken word. It'll change you forever. Yeah. And I remember going to the jail. And you got to understand, in the stateside jail, and actually county side too, nothing is separated. I mean, you got every denomination there is. There's not different church for everybody. You have one church. And I was blessed to be able to do a drug rehab class with these guys, and most of the time I just preached. I just shared my heart with them. We really didn't go through that book much. God would always lay something in my heart to help them through, to a word that they could take with them and encourage them when times got tough. And I got concerned about a certain passage. And sitting there at the second, the red light there in Munfordville, right there off the square. And I was thinking about changing the message just because I didn't want to offend somebody that was in a different denomination. I heard it plain as day. I did actually look around to see who, if somebody was shouting at me. Said that, "Josh, does my word offend you?" I've been smacked in the mouth more than once. Not physically, but by his words. I'm hard-headed, to say the least. I get it from both sides of the family. Melvin can tell you. You can't compromise the Word of God. You can't pick and choose what to believe. You can't say, "I want to believe this half, but that half's not for me." It's all or nothing, guys. And that's why he said, don't enter into this thing lightly. Don't take it for granted. Do you realize what you have? Do you truly realize that the blood covenant that you entered in with Christ, meaning that everything that was his is now yours? Man, back in the day, they used to have a big curtain up, and they'd tie a string on the priest and with a bell on it, and so they could pull him out when he entered the Holy of Holies. If it just so happened, he couldn't handle it, and he died. Whew. Now that we are heirs and joint heirs with Christ, we can stay in the holies of holies. We can stay there. We can stay in that presence. Daily. We don't have to walk out of it. What would that be like to see a whole congregation just walking around full? I'm not talking about in here. I'm talking about out there. What'd it be like to just to go to Walmart and you're so full, you're just splashing out. When I think about that, I think about the first miracle that Jesus performed. And that scripture amazes me because Jesus said, "What does this have to do with me? My time has not come." Do you think Jesus would have said that if it was a lie? Absolutely not. He said, "My time has not come." But I want you to look at what Mary done. Mary went to the servant and said, "Just do whatever he says. Just do whatever he says." You see, Mary's hunger brought in something that was meant for tomorrow. It wasn't meant for today, for that day, because he said, "My time has not come yet." But Mary's hunger brought it into that day. You see, your hunger will bring, it'll deliver, it'll make things happen. Your hunger will let you see Him. The Bible says that if you seek me, you will find me. Knock and the door shall be open. Ask and you shall receive. You see, Mary's hunger was just like that. It brought it into that day. I missed that for years, reading that scripture. Years. And there's another thing about that miracle that I want to talk to you about just for a moment. And I'm sorry if you get done before I do. You know, I won't hold it against you if you need to leave. But I just see this in my heart and I got to share it. It's another thing about that miracle that blows my mind that is whenever he said, "Go get those water pots and go fill them." You see, those pots was meant for a ritual whenever they would come in and they'd wash their hands before they entered into the room. And then I noticed one other thing that I've never noticed. Jesus never said, "Wash them out." He never said, "Clean them up, then fill them up." Never did. He said, "Just go fill them." Think about that for a minute. Then they come back with those filled pots, and he said, take it to the master first. Take it to the one over it all first. The same way as Jesus' blood had to be presented first. And he said, "This is the best." But those pots had never been washed. It's not what you do that cleans you, it's what's done inside of you that cleanses you. We're always worried about getting fixed up before we do something or straightened out before we do something. I call that the gym syndrome. You say, Josh, what do you mean by the gym syndrome? Everybody wants to get fit, then go to the gym so they look good in their clothes while they're working out. Then why in the world are you paying for a gym membership? Doesn't make any sense, does it? Because if I could do it at home first anyway, why would I want to go to the gym? Same way with washing those pots. If I could do it anyway, why do I need to be filled? If I can straighten myself out anyway, why do I need to be filled? Because we can't. It's not our job. It's our job to surrender. I remember sitting in that front row pew over there in the other church. The only reason I went to church is I thought maybe my boss would give me a raise because he'd be happy I went to church. He's sitting up there at that door, Sammy Thompson. Yeah. You think I'm lying to you? I'm not lying to you. I thought like the world did. I knew enough scripture I could make you think that I was Christian. And I just spit it off. I thought the Bible was something that the government come up with to keep people in check. Made sense to me. It really did. Conspiracy. But no, that's what I thought. I tried everything to find truth. My dad was a Baptist preacher. Strict sometimes. Things happened, and Mom and Dad got divorced when I was about 10 years old. My dad went from being seriously strict to somebody I really didn't know. That's hard to say because we lost him last year. Actually, the year before. We buried him on Christmas Eve. But my dad loved God. I can tell you that. But in the midst of that, when I was 10, you can imagine a 10-year-old being 10 and seeing somebody being very strict. And nothing's wrong with doing right. Nothing's wrong with teaching your kids right. Please do. Please correct them when they're wrong. It's okay. Unless you want disaster when they get older. But I remember, you know, when that happened and going over in my head, how can there be a God when a man of God can't even follow God's rules? It didn't make sense to me. I knew enough scripture, but it's never changed me. Everybody I've ever known that was Christian was a different person when I seen them outside the church. Come on now. Yeah. That's why you'll never see me try to be somebody else when I'm preaching. I'm going to be me whether you like it or not. You know, so there I was, and I went that way from about 10 to 19, 18 actually, and I tried different things to find truth. I remember one time even trying Wicca for a little while. You don't know what that is. That's witchcraft. Couldn't find nothing in that either. Another dead end. I'm glad some spirit didn't answer me during that. And drugs. Drugs was the next option because I could forget about my today because I was lost in Wonderland. I remember the first time I got drunk was around 11 years old. And some of the stuff's hard to tell. I'm just going to tell you the truth. When my mom and dad got divorced, my mom thought she was a teenager again. Nothing against my mom. I love my mom to pieces. She's a good woman. But her whole world was wrecked at that time. That's what you have to understand. And 10, 11 years old, we was living above the antique mall there in Horse Cave. And my aunt run the restaurant underneath. And if you know her, her name was Peggy. And she's gone to be with the Lord now. At the age of 10 and 11, if anybody remembers this, I know some people do, that where the Cracker Barrel was in Cave City used to be a big field. And everybody, all the teenagers and young 20s would hang out there on the weekends and park and socialize, and that's what they would do. But I was 10 and 11. And my mom would take me out there and just drop me off. Because she thought she knew people. You see, I know what it's like to need a daddy when you don't have a daddy there for you at the moment. You say, Josh, your dad's a good dad. Yeah, he was. Fabulous dad. But there's moments in everybody's life that they forget who they are. Like I said, at 10, 11, you can imagine what 20-year-olds put a 10 and 11-year-old up to that they have no connection to. And that's a whole nother sermon. But I remember working for Sammy. And like I said, I went to that Sunday morning because I thought maybe I'd get a raise by showing up at church. Maybe, you know, it'd make him happy and I'd get a 15, 20-cent raise, and, you know, anything, you know. That's how you think. I mean, that's how I thought. It's sad. But it's worldly. That's the only way I knew how to think. I didn't have this spirit that dwelt inside of me. It told me how to think. Or showed me how to think. And I remember sitting there. And it's funny because this, you know, I told you that I can make you think I was Christian because my dad drilled Bible verses in my head. And not only that, the Sunday school teachers, where I was made to go to church, I can remember all those Bible verses. Don't ask me how, because my wife will tell you I forget things. I'm good at it. You know, I can make a living at it. But all those verses come screaming through my head. Sunday school teachers, don't ever think that your kids are not listening or what you're doing is not doing any good. It took 19 years for what they drilled in my head to come rushing through. Don't think you're not reaching those kids just because it looks like they're not paying attention. He said, my word will not come back void.
Amen.
It has power. It has substance. The power of the spoken word. When you realize that whenever you speak, it never stops. It carries on forever and you can't get it back.
That's right.
Watch what you say. But I remember sitting there and all those Bible verses just screaming through my head. And I remember this jolly man up there preaching that I didn't know what to think about at first. Like I said, I was raised Southern Baptist. Never seen it work for anybody. And I remember sitting there and, truth be told, I was actually smoking crack cocaine whenever I got saved. I don't know how many fuzzballs I smoked thinking that I've dropped a piece. So sad. So messed up. Man. When my body was already passing out when I wasn't even high. I remember smacking my, waking up. My brother was in from the Marine Corps. I stood up off the couch and I walked into the kitchen. Next thing I know, I was in the floor. Evidently, I smacked my face on the counter on the way down. Busted my nose, just cut right through there. My brother was over top of me shaking. What in the you on, boy? I said, oh, my sugar just dropped. I was just acting like my daddy, the devil. You're either going to act like the devil or you're going to favor God. There's no ifs and ands about it. There's no one or the other. You're going to act like one of the two. I've heard this said before, that there was a fence and there's people over here and there's a fence and there's people over here and these people were following God and these people were just worldly and following the devil, and this guy couldn't make up his decision and all of a sudden everybody was gone. The ones that belonged to God went to heaven. The ones that belonged to the devil went to the lake of fire. And the devil come up and said, come on, boy, you're going with me. Nuh-uh, nope, 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 nope. I didn't choose either side. I was sitting on the fence. He said, don't you realize the fence belongs to me? It's either all or nothing, guys. And I'll be the first to tell you that I've blown it many times. Many times I've blown it and made a mistake and messed things up. And sometimes I get on a roll and at the end of the day, I'm like, oh my goodness, what have I done? I've been there. Don't ever put a pastor on a pedestal that he can't live up to. You're going to get hurt. I'm just being honest. If you don't like me, like it, you don't have to listen. It's your choice. I just want to save you some heartache. I just want you to be blessed. I want you to be able to wake up in the morning and know who you are. No longer am I Josh Jones anymore because I have this scar. I'm a child of the King. Amen. The same right that Jesus has, I have now because I'm adopted in. You know, they was fighting on who was going to get set next to him. No, I'm heir and joint heirs with Christ. Wow. Do you ever see Jesus whenever he prayed for something that he worried about it? Huh. And sometimes I see people pray over something 1,000 times and sit and watch for it to change. Just something to think about, guys. The watching is what the unbelief is. What did Jesus say to the fig tree? He said, "You're done. You will not produce no more fruit," and he just walked away. He didn't stand there and wait for it to shrivel up. He spoke to it, said, "You'll never have fruit again." And he walked to town. And then whenever they come back, the disciples was like, "Whoa, do you see that tree? It's all shriveled up, that one you spoke to." Like it's some kind of... No. I understand the authority in Christ. I understand the authority that you pack with you because you're in covenant. When I walk into a room, there should be an announcement in the spirit world that says, "A child of the Most High has walked into the room." I'm being honest. Why not? Why not stand up and be who you are in Christ? Why not? It's yours. It's more valuable than anything you could ever hope for. This world, this time here is just a vapor. We're here 1 minute, then we're gone the next. What are you going to do with it? You ever looked at a tombstone and wondered what the dash mark meant? I'm being serious. I'm not playing. I'm tired of playing games. I'm tired of playing life. I want to be who God called me to be. I want to be the man God called me to be. Are you tired of playing games? Are you tired of wondering what tomorrow holds? Are you tired of being just every day the same old thing? Finding yourself in the same traps every day? I know somebody that can get you out of the ditch, and not only get you out of the ditch, he's going to smooth that ditch over so you don't ever fall in it. And I remember sitting there on that bench and all those Bible verses ran through my head, and I knew right then, first time in my life I ever experienced this, I needed help. I could not do this on my own. I had a need for a Savior. Is either surrender or keep going the path I was going and die. My body was done shutting down even when I wasn't stoned. I knew God was real the whole time. Knew it. But I wouldn't accept it. There had to be something to it. We didn't just appear. That didn't make sense. You literally have to be insane to believe that. Or so blinded that you'd walk into a big wall because you can't see it. Or try to tell me that it's not there when it is. And I remember going up to the altar and praying, bawling my eyes out, couldn't uncontrollably, because I was broke. Mentally, physically, and spiritually, I was broke. Josh couldn't handle anymore. I remember sitting there, and here come Leon. Love that guy. Full of knowledge. So full. I remember he coming down and he's showing me the word and talking to me. He said, "That's you, ain't it? That's you, ain't it?" "Yes, sir." Changed my life. I could smile again. I was happy. God entered in and the darkness had to flee. You see, the light cometh and the darkness did not overcome it. It can't. You see, whenever I turn a light on over there, there's no darkness in here no more. Light cast away shadows and darkness. That's whenever I enter a room, no darkness can be there because the light resides within me and it shines bright and the darkness has to flee. It's not allowed to stay in there with me. It has to leave. You know how many times I've entered in a compromising position in people's lives here and that to talk to them, then all of a sudden all the anger goes away and you can talk to them sensibly? Or they calm down, they want to beat your brains out and you talk to them and before it's all over with, your friends. That's not for no reason. That's because of light in the room. It's the truth, guys. Either you believe part of it or all of it. I mean, you can't believe just this piece of it. It's all or nothing. And it's all good for you. I'm telling the truth, guys. I'm trying to encourage you. That way tomorrow you know who you are. When you wake up in the morning, I'm a child of the King. This world can't stand in my way. I refuse. I refuse to be anybody else. And when I make a mistake, I'm big enough to admit it. And I'll say I'm sorry. Christ, He covers that too. He says, "I'm just. If you'll confess. And I'll cleanse you of all unrighteousness." All of it. I can't count on my hands how many times I had to do that. I ain't even got enough toes. Just for example, and then I'll let you go. I remember when we was getting ready to move to Rhema to go to school. Everybody knows the nation was crying recession, recession, recession. I remember it plain as day. Nobody could sell a house. Houses wasn't selling. He just couldn't get rid of them. But I remember Joshua when they was crossing the river. You know, it took the priest putting the water in their feet in the water first. If that action never happened, they never walked on dry ground. Amen. Sometimes we gotta reach out in faith And every time we'd done that, when we was getting ready to move, the water would part and it would just open up. Every time. First person that looked at the house bought it. I didn't even have a high school education. I quit school when I was a sophomore. I said, God, I need a high school education to go to college, don't I? I was reading on about a fourth grade level. Amen. You want me to go to Bible college? I was done doing ministry for 2 years already in the jail. Everything was going good. You know, I'm done ministering. He said to be prepared. That's what he told me. That's all I heard. So I got my, went to Greensburg to take a GED test. Failed it miserably years ago. I mean, embarrassingly, miserably. And I went up there and took that test, and they had changed it all, of course. And you can't leave nothing alone. I got to change things up. I done kind of prepared myself for the old test. Sorry. Now it's all essays. Fourth grade education, the reading level and essays. Got this. No, I don't. So I sat there and took that test. Handed it in to the lady that evening. She said, well, all you need to do is pay me the fee and go take your test. I said, huh? In my head, I was like, did you grade the wrong paper? My name's Josh. She said, no, all you need to do is go take your test. I was like, okay. And I just mosey on out there, signed everything up, got ready to take the test. It's at Camelsville University. Went in there to take my test, sat down. There's a whole bunch of people in there. Some of them was doing it in sections where they take one section this week and then one section next week. No, I'm going to take the whole thing. Let's sit here all day. Let's get this done. You know, if I'm going to fail it, I'm going to fail it good. Let's go for it. I ended up going, finishing, turning it in, going home. I called the tutor place up there in Greensburg where they get you ready for it. I said, I was just curious. My name's Josh. I had to take that test yesterday for my GED. I was wondering if y'all had any results yet. She said, good. We was wanting to get a hold of you. I was like, oh, no. You know, I'm going to have to take it again or come in for some classes or something like that. And I didn't have time to do that. She said, I just wanted to tell you that you scored one of the highest in the state that day. I was like, huh? That's God. That didn't have nothing to do with me. Not a thing. It was me answering a call to go to Rhema. Had nothing to do with me. My high score was in reading and writing. God likes to show out sometimes. Because that had nothing to do with me. That was God proving to me what he said was true. And it was a sure thing. You take mine and Penny's paychecks we got at the baby store, we walked it by a baby when we was out there. Never thought I'd sell strollers in my life, but that's what I done. Sold baby strollers and car seats. And I had a fun time doing it. Because I got to meet these couples as soon as they was getting together for the first time. They was getting ready to get married, and they's bringing this new baby into this world, and I got to talk to them. God blessed us. At the store we woke up, they allowed both of us to work at the same store. So we got to spend time together. They allowed us to have off almost every Sunday. God's good. You're in covenant with Him. You're His child. Why do you think He was so excited whenever the one that run away come back home? He was in covenant. That's His child. His love never fails. Never fails. Never fails. Never fails. Never fails. It never fails. It never fails. His love never fails. Amen. Anybody ever use those Mr. Clean erasers? Yeah. I love them things. They clean up all my mistakes when we have them at the house. And they do a really good job on top of the stove, if you don't know that. I've actually cleaned bathtubs with them. But God, He's better than a Mr. Clean eraser. He is. There's not even a residue left. The devil will try to tell you, what about this? What about that? I don't know. God don't remember it, so why should I? Why should I hold it against myself? God don't. He's forgot it and let it go. A lot of times we're bad to hold it against ourselves and hold ourselves accountable for things that's already happened and you've not been forgiven for. And we can't let it go. And it hurts what God is telling you to do right now because you're paying more attention to your past problems than what God has called you to do right now. Amen. It's true, guys. We miss it a lot. But I want to talk to you for just 1 minute. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Please do not be looking around. If you respect me at all, you will not be looking around. I want to talk to you for just a minute that, first of all, I never give a service without offering somebody to get saved. If you want to give your life to Christ, this is your opportunity. This is your opportunity. If you said, I'm not in covenant with God, but I want to be in covenant with God. You know, I want that relationship you're talking about, that what His becomes mine and what's mine, He takes over. If you want to be in covenant with God, then you're not. You feel that beating on your chest to be in covenant with God, that you need a Savior. Trust me. That's the only way. Jesus is the only way. You'll never work it out on your own. You'll never be able to overcome it on your own. It's through Jesus. He's the way, the truth, and the life. If you say, Josh, I was listening to what you said. I'm in covenant with God, but I didn't realize that being in covenant with God was all that. That I've been living my life kind of just the way I wanted to. Not the way I was designed to. If that's you, I want to pray with you. I want to pray for you. If that's you, this altar's open. If you need to talk to me, get my attention. But before you leave the altar, I want to pray with you. And one other thing I want to talk about before I leave and let you go. There's people, in here that feel like a piece of worn out equipment. That's been set aside and not worthy to use no more. I don't know who it is. There's people that feel like their time has passed to be used. And you know you got a call in your life, you've just not been active in it. You know for a fact you got a call in your life, you can remember the time you was told. You can remember whenever the Holy Spirit dropped that inside of you. You've been pregnant with it a long time. But you think it's done past the time to use it or walk in that. I don't know who you are. I just know it's somebody in here. And it hurts. I know it hurts. Because all you desire is to be in your Father's will. Don't be afraid to walk deeper. Don't be afraid to step out in faith. If that's you, if you feel called to the ministry at all, whether it's what I was just talking about, or you feel called to the ministry and you just need somebody believing with you in faith to carry it out, I want to stand in the gap with you. I want to stand in the gap with you. I want to pray for you, but I also want you praying for me and my wife. That way we're lifting each other up. But if that's you, if you feel called to the ministry at all and you want somebody to be in covenant with you, to pray with you over that and believe with you, I want to pray for you. Not only with you, I want to pray for you. If that's you, come on, let's pray over this. Because I know this church is full of ministers. It's like looking at a brand new tractor lot with all those harvesters in there. Just waiting to be turned on. Just waiting. But what good are they if they don't ever get gassed up? What good are they if they never get gassed up? Dear Heavenly Father, I just come before you right now in the name of your Son, Jesus. God, I shared what you asked me to. Father, I thank you for being so merciful. I thank you for being in covenant with us, God. God, I thank you for taking my clothing and giving me yours. Father, I thank you for always being there and never, 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 never letting me go. That nothing can pluck me from your hand. Because I belong to you and you belong to me. I even have your weapons of warfare. Because we're in covenant together. Father, I thank you for this place just erupting on fire. Father, I thank you so much that passerbys on the road stop and knock on the door saying, "Hey, hey, hey, there's smoke coming from the roof." And it has nothing to do with a literal fire, God, but the fire of the Holy Ghost resting on this place. Stir us up, God, please. God, I'm crying to you to stir us up. Like kids that get excited, God, stir us up. Father, please. God, I thank you for resting in this place. God, send who you want to here. Bring them in. But if they need to leave, send them away. I put a hedge of protection on this place, God. God, I pray right now that God, that you just surround this place with your angels. Nothing meant to harm can enter through. I pray over these people, God. I pray over their lives, God. God, I ask you just to touch them. God, I ask you to touch them from the top of their heads to the soles of their feet. God, that some of this I may have said today that you brought forth in my belly, God, and shot out my mouth. God, I ask that it just dwells inside of them, God. God, in some part of it brings them to a realization that the covenant is more than just a okay. It's more than just a I believe. God, I ask you to touch their children. Protect them. Be with them. Keep them safe. Let them see in their parents what they need to be. God, I ask that we are living sacrifices to you. God, I pray that we smell good. It's a sweet smell. On our job site, God, I ask you to go before us. God, I ask that you remind me that in the workplace, I'm the same there as I am here in this pulpit. That way we're not like being tossed to and fro. Just chasing every little religion that comes around. But know, God, that we are steadfast in your word. God, that we find you in your word. You said, "Seek me and you'll find me." And Father, I thank you that these people are seeking you. And they're going to find you beyond measure. God, I thank you right now, God, that your Holy Spirit rest upon them. Encourage them, God. God, I just want them to know that you're so real. That you're more real than the air they breathe. You're the creator, God. You're the one said, "Let it be," and it was. That we are nothing on our own without you. We are simply a creation without direction without you. Father, I thank you. And I ask that you be with them as they go this week. Father, I know you're coming soon. I know it's not going to be long. God, and I also know that we're here for such a time as this. That we're not a mistake. That God, you intended us for us to be here at this time. I take that as a privilege, God. Because you chose us for this time. Because you know we're going to have to fight. That it wasn't going to be easy. But God, you chose us for this time. Prepare us, oh God. Strengthen us. And God, I thank you. I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.